In her work with the Newsweek educational program, she became more familiar with the UN in writing curriculum for Newsweek on global topics. She was subsequently invited by the UN to write curriculum for their educational website on the Millennium Developmental Goals Committee and Panel, and thus has a key interest in today's topic on sustainable developmental goals. In the meantime, she went from teaching high school to adjunct professor position with a number of universities in the Seattle area, training teachers in how to teach social studies. After she moved there with her husband, the Millennium Development Goals were the UN plan to welcome in the new millennium with a set of 8 broad goals, which were agreed upon by all 189 members at that time. The first such agenda, which received universal endorsement. The United Nations Development Program, the largest of the UN specialized agencies, which charged with setting up identifiable indicators, precise targets, which could be measured, collecting frequent data from all UN members as to the progress they were making in reaching these goals. There was strong emphasis on improving the conditions of the poorest on the planet, and the goal specifically targeted that populations were appropriate, aiming to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger, achieve universal primary education, promote gender equality and empower women, reduce child mortality, improve maternal health, combat HIV, AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, ensure environmental sustainability, and promote global partnership for development. Joanne will tell you what a report revealed in 2015. So please welcome Joanne.
Before we get to talking about the MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, and the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, I'd like to read you in a responsive reading. So if you would join me with number 602. And as you can guess, we'll ask you to read the italic version. If there is to be peace in the world,
there must be peace in the nations.
If there is to be peace in the nations,
there must be peace in the cities.
If there is to be peace in the cities,
there must be peace between neighbors.
If there is to be peace between neighbors,
there must be peace in the home.
If there is to be peace in the home,
there must be peace in the heart.
These appear to be timely words in today's time. I also wanted to reference that, you know, when Cindy opened up the program by reading the charter, the introduction to the charter, that's a 70-year-old document. So you can begin to understand how visionary were the founders of this organization. And also I'm thinking when you were reflecting after you got your award, realize you're the only church in Louisiana that holds that distinction.
Wow.
So, we have to give that a so congratulations to you. Okay, let's move on. I should have said this in the beginning, but good morning. But as they might say in the United Nations, how about if we all do this together? The French would say, bonjour.
Bonjour.
And the Spanish speakers would, of course, say, buen día.
Buen día.
The Chinese would say, ni hao ma.
Ni hao ma.
The Arabic speakers, of whom there are many, would say, salam alaikum. And our Russian friends would say,
Rabbi Yudhu. Rabbi
Yudhu. It's really a privilege to be with you this morning, and I was delighted when I got a phone call from Reverend Jim saying that I could come. I bring you greetings as well from our North Shore Unitarian Society, and a heartiest congratulations. We have our work to do here to bless. See if we can get on that list. As the time is short, I wanted to begin by following up on the introduction, and we're going to try to do a bit of a slideshow here. So if you were at the UN office in New York, you'd be in the Church Center, which is right across the street from the United Nations, and if you would look out on one of the windows looking onto First Avenue, this is the UN that you see. They literally are right across the street from the entrance. Couldn't be any perfect place. And they share the building with a number of religiously related organizations that are known as NGOs, non-governmental organizations. And so, as we move on to the next slide, just to give you the verbiage, you know, and the acronyms which go along with everything these days. The MDGs, remember, were a remarkable set of 8 goals. They were actually designed by the staff at the UNDP and the United Nations Development Program, which kind of monitored the goals. And they presented and they got unanimous acceptance by 189 countries at that time. When time came to evaluate, the UNDP was evaluating them all along, every year, every country was sending their data. So that, as you can see, let's see what they evaluated, and that's going to look on the next slide. This was the first goal, okay? And it says Millennium Goal 1 to eradicate hunger, and that was universally accepted. We're going to make the world a better place. Let's recognize we have awful poor people. At that point, it was 1/3 of the population that was living on less than $1.25 a day. 1/3 of the world. It's a big number. Okay? So how do you change that? Okay, you move on and you set a target. Okay? And you said, let's ask each country each year, how well are you doing addressing the poor in your country? Okay? So the target tells you to, the goal is in the 15-year period to halve that number per country. I mean, it would be high in the sky to take care of it all, so at least you get halfway there. And then each country was being asked annually to report in how well are you doing. Okay. And the data that they collected, you'll see that in the next slide, okay, are called the indicators. And that means which agency or which outfits do you look at to look at that data and see, well, how well are we doing with meeting this goal? Okay, do you know how well we did? The world? Okay. By the end of 2015, well, let's start as well. In 1990, half the population of the developing world met the criteria of being the poorest of the poor. In 2015, that portion dropped to 14%, down from 50%, with most of the change occurring after the year 2000. We now have a larger middle class in the developing world. Now that's an amazing movement, okay? And it tripled, actually. And we have fewer undernourished people because that goal also was targeting the hungry. Now, one of the things that you'll notice is I've indicated on the right-hand side of the slide the Sustainable Development Goals. And that means, so when that 15-year period was over, already by 2013, the UN was looking ahead to say, what about the next 15 years? So, and the outreach was different. The outreach was, instead of having a kind of a select group select the goals, they asked millions, and I mean millions of people. They asked all the governments, they asked a range of NGO organizations. I remember in Seattle getting a questionnaire, what do you think the Sustainable Development Goals should be? I don't know if people here were involved in that as well, the United Nations. So the absolutely agreed upon thesis for this next set of goals is we still have to attack hunger. So that became number one. Okay. So you'll see, if you want to follow it along, on this part of your sheet, and they always come up with these nifty little icons, okay? I didn't have room to get the nifty little icons. But you'll see They took the one goal and separated into one and two. Okay, let's move on. The second goal was to achieve universal primary education. Well, that actually translated to meaning at least a fourth grade education for every child in the world. They didn't even hope for eighth grade. Okay? How did we do? Well, the number of out-of-school children for primary age has fallen by almost half. So that means half the kids that weren't in school are now in school. That's a big number, okay? That means 100 million in the year 2000. The out-of-school children were 100 million in the year 2000. They're now 57 million. This doesn't mean that this work is not to be continued. So you'll notice goals 4 and 5 on this sheet. New set are continuing the goals of focusing on primary education. Now we're getting into goal 3, and that's talking about gender equality and empowering women. Well, how did we do? Well, many more girls are now in school compared to 15 years ago. The target was reached for the primary schools, the secondary schools, and the tertiary schools. Yay for our team. I love being in education because I feel proud of that now. There are more women paid workers outside the agricultural sector, so more women are working beyond just doing the farming, which has been historically their role. And also in the parliaments, we're getting many more female voices in the parliaments around the world. In nearly 90% of the 174 countries, there are female representatives. There are only 1 in 5, so we've got some more work to do. So notice that goal 5 shows up on here. We're still trying to help women worldwide. We're trying to do that in this country right now, right? Okay, goal 4. This is talking about child mortality. The phraseology of this has changed, but I can remember when the goal was actually reached, and that was I think it was 2013. I can remember those agencies like Save the Children coming out and said, you know, we were really trying to reduce child mortality, and by George, we've done it, and they did it ahead of time. And I can remember the NGO community was extremely excited about that, and made news in the NGO community. Which we'll talk about later. So there is good news as well to eliminate measles and polio, which was included under this. And you know the organizations that are helping to that, like Rotary Club is helping. We're almost there for polio, and we're way up there for measles. Okay, so there's been definite progress in reducing those. But in the new range, they said, well, okay, you just talked about children, but there are health issues all over the place. And all of us, the whole of us, have to be taken care of. So you notice here how the new goals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 10, are now talking about health issues. Remember, the new goals are the voices of the people of the world. This is where they want to move towards making a better world. Okay? As we move on to goal 5, this is just talking about maternal health. Again, kind of a narrow grouping. We're talking about women. Women in general, maternal health means childbirth, particularly. In other words, not old women, not young women, but the women who are bearing children. The results show from the data are fewer women are dying in childbirth. And we were talking about women in the developing world who were 12, and 13, and 14, are still marrying very young, and just don't make it through childbirth. So there's been a definite improvement in that area. The new goals address these concerns in goal 3, okay? Because we're still continuing the focus on women and health, their health. But we're saying all people's health now. I mean, we don't want to, you know, there are men here too, and they have their problems, and we want to be inclusive about including the male part of our population. When you're talking about goal 6, now you're specifically looking at 3 areas of health that were certainly of big concern back in the 1990s when they were drafting this. I mean, we were hearing a lot about HIV and its spreading worldwide. Well, you might recall that President Bush, bless his soul, created an initiative when he announced the financing of U.S. efforts in combating HIV. And then when President Obama came in, he continued this focus. What's the result? There's been a 40% fall in the number of people who are getting AIDS between 2000 and 2013. By June 2014, 13.6 million people living with HIV were in fact receiving antiretroviral therapy globally. There was a whole big to-do about drug companies charging too much. That has been resolved. There's good news on that end. Do you remember when some of the Carter Center but other NGOs were trying to attack malaria, and I wouldn't be surprised if your congregation wasn't helping support malaria nets. If you've done that, that's all part of the big picture. So we have seen progress made in those reductions, both malaria and measles. Of course, then came Ebola, and then came the Zika virus. So you'll notice that the concentrations in the new goals don't specifically target AIDS. Matter of fact, USAID just had a program the other day talking about AIDS in South Africa, and they are actually looking to the end of AIDS. I mean, there's hope now to actually talk in those terms, which is amazing. That doesn't mean we really conquered Ebola and Zika's, you know, there's still some problems children out there in the field of health. So that's why the goal has to be inclusive now, to look at whichever health issues are on the agenda. For goal 7, now that's a very, very interesting goal, because in that one goal out of 8, they looked at the environment. Now, those of us who were following those environmental conferences know there just wasn't one agenda, the environment. There was, and when they spelled it out in environmental goals for the MDGs, they looked at clean water, they looked at climate change and ozone depletion, they looked at terrestrial and marine protection, protecting our green spaces on the land, and certainly protecting the fisheries and the resources. See, improvements in sanitation, that means defecating in the streets to be otherwise about. Improvements in Slumdog Millionaire was, remember that movie? It was a very eye-opening look at what slums were like. The freedom and ozone depleting substance, you remember Freon? Mm-hmm. Why haven't we heard about Freon? It worked. It really worked. They don't make refrigerators with Freon anymore. Mm-hmm. All right? So we, that has virtually been eliminated. Okay. So, and they're saying that the ozone layer is expected to recover by the middle of this century. So we're not there yet, but we're certainly on the road. Okay. The 1.9 million people have gained access to piped drinking water since 1990. Do you even know that 1.9 million people didn't have access to clean water? I mean, we're talking about the women and the children who carry it on their heads from the center of the village. That's still a huge number. Still. But it's better. Much better. In 147 countries, they met their target. In 95 countries, they met the target for sanitation. And that's talking about trying to reduce public defecation, which would be going on in some areas. 77 countries have met both. So I hope you're getting the feeling that there's been some good news that you should have been hearing about, because that's the intent of this program. Let's look at goal number 8. This goal really addressed the encouragement of increasing financial aid and assistance of the developed world to the developing world. Because remember, most of these goals were affecting in proportionately more of the people in the developing world. So how can they meet the goals? Well, let's ask the developed world to do their part. Okay, what do we do? Well, there's been a 66% increase in the real terms of overseas development aid between the year 2000 and 2014. So more countries are giving more money to foreign aid. Denmark, Luxembourg, Norway, Sweden, and the UK continue to exceed the UN's official development assistance. They ask for 0.7%. We're somewhere into 0.01, if we even made that percent. So we haven't matched the UN goal yet, but there are countries that are working on it. I keep on thinking about the number of imports from developing Alabama because it was a developing country back then? Well, 79% of imports from developing were admitted duty-free, and that's up from 65%. So when you think about Buy American, also think about supporting some of our overseas friends, because they can still use that support. Mobile phone users was one of the things that they were tracking back in the year 2000 and the 90s. That increased tenfold during this period. And internet use was 6% back in 2000. Guess where it is now? What do you think? 12%. Internet users around the world. 50%? Close, 43%. And interestingly enough, I was just reading a Time magazine. They actually had a section in there that said, you know, Facebook. Everybody in the world uses Facebook. Everybody in the English speaking, a lot of people in the English speaking world. But you know, the English speakers aren't the dominant force here. You know, Chinese speakers outnumber us by the deal. So they have their platforms. You know, I mean, you know, we're a lot of 6,900 languages out there. So we cannot believe that everybody does what we do, because they don't. So we're a different world today, thanks to the Millennium Development Goals. And in this new world, voices from around the world are now reflected in meeting those goals. So the buy-in in 2015, when we put this out, the buy-in was much, much faster because people had been asked and their suggestions showed up. So there's wonderful news for this next 15-year period. I remember when Microsoft, living in Seattle at that time, I remember when Microsoft signed on, and that was part of an effort that the UN supporters back when they was in Iraq. Global compact, you're going to reach out to corporations, come on, you know. And you're asking them to agree to human rights law and environmental law and labor law? It'll never happen. Right? Come on, guys. Basically, that's not the corporations. Because guess what? 8,000 have signed on. 4,000 have from academic institutions and other NGOs and other organizations and church could sign on to it. Okay? Could sign on to the Global Compact. And now it's 12,000 entities around the world working with the UNDP and their governments. Okay? And there are 193 governments now. That if we agree on a goal, hey, you know, we might make it. We have 15 years. I just wanted to tell you, how did we do here in our country? Right. Well, the goals were, I mean, the kinds of things they were talking about, living on $1.25 a day. Fortunately, our poor have a little bit more money than that. So in some of the cases, we didn't keep track because we didn't need to keep track. Okay, we had most of our children in school. There are a few that aren't, but most of them are. So the set of goals really were not directed towards us. But the nice part is the government released that we had from July 2016 from our State Department. And listen to this. Building on more than a half century of global leadership, including the creation of the Millennium Challenge Coalition and the President's Emerging Plan for AIDS, PEPFAR, and those were two entities under President Bush's administration, President Obama issued the first U.S. Global Development Policy in 2010. Now listen to this, this is really interesting. For the first time, global development was elevated on a par with diplomacy and defense as a core pillar of American engagement. We're really trying to reach out there, besides being diplomats and supplying military assistance. We're trying to reach out there.
Donald Trump gets elected.
And we have aligned ourselves with what they call the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, which is the grand plan, which is kind of spelled out in much more detail, what I'm giving you a glimpse of today. There's a program under our, I guess the State Department, called Feed the Future. There's the Power Africa. There's the promise of an AIDS-free generation. Across these and other efforts, as mandated by President Obama's policy, are investments in development reflect increased and more strategic collaboration between and among a broad array of U.S. government and departments. So global outreach is something we've actively supported. and we will hopefully continue to support it. Sounds to me like we're on the right track, and maybe I'm not the only optimist in the room. Through the advocates of the SDGs, there are advocates for the SDGs that have been pushing and pushing and pushing our government to keep on doing these things. Okay? Do you know the results? Do you know that organization? Any takers here? Any membership? Okay, that was big in Seattle, and they're an active group. They're very, very interesting group. They target whatever legislation is relevant to now the Sustainable Development Goal, target what legislation has been introduced, where is that legislation, in what committee, and then they target all the committee members, and all the committee members get letters relevant to that particular legislation relating to that particular SDG, and this is what they do. They cannot rule. So it's a fascinating thing, and because the legislators are getting these letters that are relevant to the bill that just got proposed, hey, you know, there's somebody out there who's listening. Maybe I can do some good. And they do. And that's why they call themselves results. Anyway, it's a very exciting organization. I think some of you might be interested in that. And as far as our own UU organization, I wanted to say that you mentioned October 30th. October 30th, we are having Bruce Knotts come. He's going to be speaking at our North Shore, but I understand, I know that they were trying to have him come here. You are more than welcome to join us for our service. And if you haven't met Bruce Knotts, he's the director of the UWM office. He is a former State Department official, and he is one heavy-duty man in the human rights field and in the disarmament field in the NGO community. I mean, his positions are amazing, because there are thousands and thousands of NGOs, and those are the lobbyists worldwide that look at their government and try to push their government. So, yeah, he's an important man. So we'll be coming to town. First time in Louisiana ever.
Yeah.
So do you have a date on that? Do you know about that?
Of when he's coming in?
Yeah.
We're trying to get him for the Center for Ethical Living lectures. I met him, amazing guy. And yeah, so he's going to come and he wants to spend a lot of time with us.
Yeah.
So we need to make the opportunity. This guy is amazing. So we really, and he was very impressed. We had a really great congregation, by the way. So yeah, so he'll be coming in probably for about a week or two. So we want to make sure that y'all hear him and come and support him.
Yeah. I mean, nobody's supposed to come from the South. I don't know if he's from Louisiana or not, but he really does.
He's
getting encouraged. Anyway, it's exciting news. And just to let you know what he said, in the next one. We started our affiliation with the UN the year after the GA started to meet, which is an interesting position, okay? And so,
can you read that? Can you read it for you? Can you read it?
Let me read it? Okay.
Yes.
Be it resolved that the Unitarian Universalist Association reaffirm its support of the United Nations. Be it further be resolved that we urge American support of the United Nations in abolishing disease, literacy, and hunger, and thereby decrease international tension and to lay the groundwork for a genuine peace with justice.
Okay, that was 1962. So this is what Bruce said recently. What was true in 62 is even truer in 2016. We have endured decades of anti-UN propaganda, and believe me, this is real. And decades of crass neglect of what the UN does, and that's real as well. Most Americans are unaware of the Paris Climate Talks. Remember those from last December? We had that historic agreement on the environment. Well, that was organized by the United Nations. Paris hosted it, but the organizational part of it was UN today. The United Nations organized 20 such talks before Paris. So how did they reach the agreement in that short term, because of the 20 meetings that they had before. Peace, education, human rights, climate change, sustainable development, and more happens because of the coordination via the United Nations of efforts by member states and civil society efforts. And you know, they call it member states of their countries. I mean, I know you think it's Louisiana's, but their countries. So he asks, please cut through the propaganda. Trust your UN old office to keep you informed of what the UN is doing, and that you're not reading from a local press. Maybe you want to write some letters to the editor. Sounds like a humanitarian thing to do. Thank you very, very much for your attention. I hope you're a believer. I certainly am.